Good morning, everyone. Nice to see you on this Friday morning. I'm Tom Beering, along with Wendy DeMartini and Rhonda Fettig. Folks, bundle up. It's chilly out there this morning. It's kind of back to reality. Cool breeze. No snow, but it is nastily cold.
Yeah, it is. Scary.
How are the Thanksgiving and Christmas plans coming, by the way?
Not so good.
How's the Christmas shopping coming?
Behind. Typical.
What else is new? And it's what we got the weather for.
That's right. And we're going to show you a feature this morning on new Christmas trends. The traditional going home for Christmas is yielding to holiday Christmas vacation packages. We'll show you two popular choices for this Christmas.
Wendy, Christmas is coming early for some arthritis sufferers. Dr. John Irwin, the medical director of the Inflammation Institute at UND, will be here to share about a program that significantly reduces arthritic pain. We'll also show you a movie preview of Paramount Pictures' The Addams Family, which opens tonight nationally, and a feature from our visit with the Denver Broncos quarterback, John Elway.
UND women's basketball coach Jean Roebuck will be on today before their season opener. And get ready to drool. The Pear Tree's executive chef, Brent Kopp, will show us how to make the holidays look better and taste better.
Yeah, we got a glimpse of that this morning. Bib is required. We'll get to weather and sports in just a little bit, but first, Rhonda, with some overnight headlines and other news. Rhonda?
Thanks, Tom. The stalled Middle East peace process may soon be up and running again. A second round of Arab-Israeli peace talks has been set for early next month in Washington, D.C. The U.S. issued that invitation because Arabs and Israelis couldn't agree on where to meet next. The time and place won't be official until all participants respond, possibly by a Monday deadline. The head of the Palestinian delegation is on his way to Moscow to discuss the peace process with Soviet leaders. Israeli Prime Minister Yitzhak Shamir will meet with President Bush today. Shamir says there is room for compromise in upcoming peace talks. President Bush has signed a landmark civil rights bill, but has still managed to enrage civil rights leaders. The controversy is over a presidential directive that would have halted all federal affirmative action programs. The White House retracted that language, saying Chief Counsel Boyden Gray released the statement before showing it to the president. The new civil rights bill makes it easier for minorities and women to sue their employers for job discrimination. Bush vetoed a stronger version of the bill last year. Dealing with cancer can be a traumatic experience. Studio One reporter Shelley Amberg visited with a University of North Dakota teacher who is not about to let cancer get in the way of her students.
Teachers are probably the most important role models in the world, and they have different reasons for doing their job. But teaching has taken on a new meaning for Graciela Wilborn. She does it to keep herself going.
It's breast cancer, and the doctor is very optimistic, and the treatments are hard. I feel very, very weak after each chemotherapy, and I have to recover for 2 or 3 days, but then I'm all right again, and I'm here. I have been teaching since then.
Graciela found out she had cancer in late September, and she has chemotherapy treatments every Wednesday. She uses the weekends to recuperate, but the chemotherapy hasn't stopped her from teaching the classes she loves.
It's my life. I love to teach. I have strength, and I think it's better for me to continue living my life as it is.
Graciela told her students about her cancer right away. She says she is close to her students, and she wanted them to know.
I don't really see any difference in her teaching methods between now and before we found out that she had cancer. She seems to handle it well. She's always very enthusiastic.
Cancer may dampen many people's spirits, but Graciela Wilborn is an inspiration to us all. With photographer Steve Rogers, Shelley Amberg, Studio One News.
UND's chapter of the American Civil Liberties Union presented ACLU staff attorney Simon Heller earlier this week. Heller is lead counsel in the Fargo Women's Health Organization versus Sinner case, a lawsuit opposing the 1991 amendments to the North Dakota Abortion Control Act. Heller says the act has a great impact in North Dakota because it creates burdens for women who have decided to have an abortion. Heller also says the ACLU supports a woman's right to choose abortion anytime during her pregnancy. The ACLU is a nonprofit, nonpartisan public interest organization that attempts to protect Americans' basic civil rights. The 18 members of the University of North Dakota Presidential Search Committee have been busy these last few weeks. The committee is searching for a successor for retiring UND President Tom Clifford. The committee is made up of community and faculty members, as well as two students. They were selected by the new Chancellor of Higher Education, Douglas Treadway. The committee has had several organizational meetings to determine the qualities they are looking for in the new president.
Someone that will give us both academic and administrative leadership that will serve a large number of constituencies, including the large North Dakota community, students, faculty, staff.
The committee will begin screening applicants in January and have been asked to complete their work by the end of March. The Board of Higher Education hopes to select the new president sometime in April. If two senators have their way, there could be more money and less hassle for students trying to get college loans. The Financial Aid for All Students Act of 1991 would offer scholarships to top students, and Pell Grants would be issued directly to students. Republican Senator David Durenberger from Minnesota and Democratic Senator Paul Simon of Illinois offered the proposal after a report by the General Accounting Office said replacing the GSL program with direct loans could save the government up to $1 billion a year. When students complete their studies, they would make payments to an education loan account through increased income tax withholding by their employer. However, opponents of the proposal say it would only increase the current federal debt. And in the second half hour, Wendy, we'll see why some adults over 30 can afford to go back to school.
Great, thanks, Rhonda. It's almost Thanksgiving, and Katie, I can't believe there's not more snow.
Keep your fingers crossed, Wendy, because it doesn't look like any is coming. Let's take a look at current conditions in Grand Forks. Right now we've got a temperature of 13 degrees, winds are out of the northwest at 15 miles per hour, and humidity is at 73%. On our national map, we've got a low pressure system on the east coast here, and that's bringing a steady stream of rain from New England all the way down into Georgia. 60 degrees throughout most of the southeast and through the south. However, there are some record-breaking temperatures in Florida, especially in the southern tip here, 80 degrees today, maybe even 85 into the 90s. We do have a winter storm system brewing in the midwestern section of the nation, and that will be bringing some snow into the panhandle of Nebraska, down into Kansas, and also over into Iowa. Heavy accumulations of snow in Steamboat, Colorado, perfect for skiing conditions. In the western part of the nation, we've got a Pacific storm system moving in, and we shouldn't be feeling that till Monday, maybe Tuesday. On our regional map, in Grand Forks, we've got a temperature of 13, Fargo, we're at 16, Bismarck at 17, and Williston, North Dakota, 18 degrees. Our cold spot is Winnipeg, Manitoba at 10 degrees, and in Minnesota, International Falls, 21 degrees, Duluth and Minneapolis-St. Paul at 30 and 31. Sioux Falls, South Dakota is at 29 degrees. Today, we're looking for temperatures in the 20s. Winds will be out of the northwest at 15 to 20 miles per hour, and maybe some light flurries this afternoon. This evening, temperatures 5 to 10 degrees. Winds will be out of the northwest at 5 to 15 miles per hour, and no rain or snow for this evening. Our extended weather outlook for the weekend, Saturday, cloudy, temperatures in the teens, and Sunday, sunny skies, temperatures in the 20s. So, Wendy, it's going to be kind of chilly, but no rain or snow.
That's not too bad.
No, it isn't. That's a given this time of the year. Let me be blunt about it.
Yeah, but at least there's no snow.
Yeah, that's right.
The Timberwolves are off to a slow start.
Yeah, they are, but you know what? When they're happier, they have a new coach. He plays a much more relaxed game, and the players love him. But in this case, happiness doesn't translate into wins. The Minnesota Timberwolves hold the distinction of having the worst record in the NBA. And last night, they added to it. Hang on, our whirlwind tour of last night's NBA highlights begins in Houston, where the Wolves dropped to 1-9. Kenny Smith and Otis Thorpe both score 19. Rockets win it 106-102. Houston now 8-2, matching their best franchise start. Last night's win for Houston came without center Hakeem Olajuwon, who is hospitalized with an irregular heartbeat. He could miss the next two games. For the second time this week, the Blazers drill the Clippers 106-91, the final from the Sports Arena in L.A. Clyde Drexler with his usual standout performance, 24 points, 11 rebounds. The Clippers have now lost their last five. Mark Price scored 18 of his 24 in the fourth quarter to give Cleveland a 116-112 come-from-behind win against New Jersey, Brad Doherty leading the Cavs with 26. Into baseball, reports out of Chicago last night say former Seattle Mariners skipper Jim Lefevre will be named as the new manager of the Chicago Cubs. Last year, Lefevre guided Seattle to their first winning season in franchise history. Lefevre would replace Jim Essien, who was fired last month. A full NFL schedule between Sunday and Monday night with every team in action this week. Washington, Houston, New Orleans clinched division titles with a win. NFL expansion, the center of off-field discussions. The league says a meeting with the NFL commissioner, the league president, and 10 groups hoping to land a 1994 franchise has been set for December 10th and 11th in New York. Each group will give a 45-minute pitch, 45 minutes to answer questions. The cities of Oakland, Baltimore, and St. Louis, each losing their teams to relocation, are all in the hunt. Now, before we move on, here's a complete run of last night's basketball and hockey scores. Baseball's off-season bidding for a record number 99 free agents will continue to escalate player salaries. And the effects of high-priced contracts have already been felt. Major League Baseball reports that profits declined 33% in 1990 to $143 million. The Players Relations Committee say they expect a continued slide to show in the 1991 figures next year at the same time. Revenues in 90 increased 7.7%, while salaries went up to 20%. In 91, salaries jumped to 53%. It appears baseball's financial noose is getting short fast. The long and lonely road of cross-country track takes the UND women's team to Edwardsville, Illinois Saturday to compete in the national meet for the first time ever as a team. UND has been ranked sixth nationally all year, so expectations are very, very high.
We probably, of any team in the nation, we're probably the ones that have had to train in the worst conditions with being outside all the time and not being able to train indoors. And so as far as weather, I really don't believe that's going to be a factor.
Realistically, I think we can get in the top six. We knew we were going to be pretty competitive in the conference. We got a couple of good recruits in from junior college transfers and a couple other returning people, and we knew that we were going to be a team that was going to be up there this year.
Clay says his top two runners, Steph Brunig and Louise Ronnerman, have an excellent chance to finish in the top 10. Men's basketball tips off its season tomorrow night against Simpson College at the Hislop Sports Center. The Sioux will play with a balance of veterans and newcomers, which they hope will make a successful combination.
The main thing will just be that the few of the new guys will just get used to playing the type of ball we've played for the last couple of years here, and that we just get out and play good, solid defense like we've done in the past and shoot the ball well from the perimeter.
I learned, we got to play more together, and, we got to cut down on the turnovers that we've been making, but all in all, I feel, we've been doing a real good job.
UND is expected to be a favorite in the NCC this year, along with South Dakota and South Dakota State. UND hockey team Wendy comes home after three road trips. They've been swept the last two weekends, so tonight and tomorrow night are going to be critical at Ingolstadt Arena. They go up against Michigan Tech. They need a win.
And they need some luck.
Yep.
It's 12 minutes after the hour. UND women's basketball play their season opener tomorrow night. Coach Jean Roebuck will join us, and we'll also show you two popular vacation spots for Christmas.
Both of those a little later in our first half hour, but up next, a program to significantly reduce that arthritic pain. We're glad to have you along. We'll be right back after this.
Building for the future doesn't just happen. It takes time, planning, and a lot of hard work. It also takes people like you who overlook the inconveniences construction creates and a staff that's committed to providing quality banking services. During these final months of construction at Community National Bank, we pledge our best to limit these inconveniences and to make it up to you in warm, friendly, professional service. Because at Community National Bank, we care about you.
Advertisers are looking for just one thing from their advertising dollars: results. And that's what local cable TV advertising delivers. Results for local area businesses like ID Motor Company and Scott's Piano and Sound. Cablecom delivers results for these area clients. Let us deliver results for your business. Contact Cablecom for more information on local cable TV advertising at rates similar to radio.
Thousands of forest fires are started by people who never realize what they've done. Some never even set foot in the forest.
Welcome back to Studio One. It strikes millions and sets no age limit on its victims. Arthritis is a rheumatoid disease that primarily attacks joints and tendons, rendering them almost inoperable. Dr. John Irwin, medical director of the Inflammation Institute at UND, joins us this morning. And he's got good news. We've asked him to share about microdose therapy, a six-month program that can significantly reduce arthritic pain. Dr. Irwin, a pleasure to meet you.
Good morning, Tom.
And good to have you on.
Nice to be here.
How much of a breakthrough is this for arthritis?
I think it's a considerable breakthrough. All the standard treatments of the past have been of some help, but very limited amount. And we really feel that we're doing at least twice as good and maybe even more than that. We have it under study at the present time and development.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Irwin, how effective has it been? How can you measure that?
Well, we have done what we call blinded trials, whereby patients have been given the real medicine and other patients have been given fake medicine, or what we call placebos. And we've measured the degree of effectiveness that way. And we have pretty well demonstrated that we can remove 75% of the pain from about 86% of the people.
It's a 6-month program, and the way I understand it requires a lot of rigid discipline on the part of the patient. Could you explain a little bit about the program?
The program is a time of training. The actual therapy goes for the rest of one's life. Mm-hmm. But we are, in this 6 months' time, are teaching them how to be their own doctor. It's not really terribly rigid, but we teach the people how to monitor their own systems of pain in their joints. We have what we call diary sheets, on which the patients tabulate the amount of pain that they have in their various joints. And by learning these things, they manage their own dosage of medicine at home.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now the Institute, we should probably make something clear in this, Dr. Irwin, the Institute does not practice medicine. It is more of a research experimental center, is that correct?
That's true. Patients come to us for our analysis of what their problem might be, our development of a treatment that will relieve their symptoms. And when we have conquered their problem, hopefully, we don't conquer them all, we wish we could, mm-hmm. but when we've conquered the problem, we return that patient to the doctor of their choice with a letter telling them exactly what we have done.
And Dr. Irwin, what is the medical community saying when they get him back? Are they coming alongside of you and saying, yes, this is bringing some solution?
We are just getting started. We are hopeful that people will be very receptive of our ideas. But that's yet to be experienced because we just got started a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah. Let's go back to the basics of arthritis. How accurate is it that it only affects the elderly? And it affects people in cold or damp weather. Is that still very accurate?
Well, to a certain small degree it is, but it actually starts affecting people almost from birth on, because there is a juvenile arthritis that starts at very early ages of life. However, the most common time for arthritis is probably after about the age of 50.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. There's an interesting twist to this story, and I want you to share it. You've personally been affected by arthritis.
That's right.
Share a little bit about that.
Well, I've had arthritis for about 25 or 30 years. It gradually developed, and when I went to my doctors, at first they said, there's something perhaps in here, because they couldn't find any tests or actual evidence that there was anything wrong. Mm-hmm. But I knew there was something wrong because I could feel the symptoms.
Mm-hmm.
And that's been translated into our present system of diagnosis of patients, that we use their symptoms as our basic measure of what their problem might be.
Where will the program go from here if it continues successful? My last question for you, where will it go from here?
This goes to the other doctors who are practicing rheumatology. It will hopefully go to magazines of medical publication throughout the world.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But you know what? I still have a hunch. The best way to deal with it is get out of the cold weather. Let's get out of here and go to Hawaii.
Well, I lived in Saipan for 1 year. And there, the coldest day of winter was 77 degrees. And they have very distinct arthritis mm-hmm. in that tropical mm-hmm. climate.
Yeah, it's a myth. Dr. Irwin, it's a pleasure talking to you. We're thrilled for you and for all the people that have arthritis who are suffering from it. A wonderful solution. And we're glad to have you on the show. Now they know how to get in touch, so we appreciate that. Good to meet you.
Certainly been a pleasure to be here and have a chance to put forth our ideas.
Good to have you. Dr. John Irwin, we're coming up on 20 minutes after the hour. Wendy will be back with a couple favorite Christmas travel destinations right after this.
XL93, the number one hit music station. I'm Colin Davis. Coming up this hour,
XL93 Office Check.
Hi, where are you calling from?
From an office downtown.
XL93, the top five at five. Freeway party with Joey Rhodes.
It's Rock and Rick on XL93.
Yo, baby, yo, the nine. XL93, the number one hit music station. I'm Pat Mars.
Knocking down 12 in a row every hour.
At least 50 minutes of nonstop music.
Only on XL93.
Whoever thought this would happen? Whoever thought a teacher from West Virginia would be teaching a class in Budapest?
Good morning.
But here I am, part of the first Peace Corps team in Eastern Europe. We're here to help Hungarian teachers learn how to teach English. It's an amazing time to be here. For these people, English is the language of opportunity, and they can't get enough of it.
How are you doing today?
Great, great.
But language isn't the only thing we share. I'm learning Hungarians are a lot like we are. They love their freedom, and they're open to new ideas.
And new words of freedom, and the government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth.
We all have a lot of work ahead of us, but I can't think of any job I'd rather have.
Be part of the future with the Peace Corps, the toughest job you'll ever love.
The traditional preference of enjoying the Christmas holidays at home is yielding to the trend for holiday travel. Resort hotels throughout the United States are enticing travelers, 25 million of them, to different holiday packages during the Christmas season. If Disney can, why can't they? Studio One producer Maria Volk with two of these holiday destinations that have all the scenery built right inside, creating a unique Christmas experience.
Celebrating Christmas doesn't necessarily mean staying at home anymore. More than 25 million Americans travel during the Christmas holidays, according to the American Automobile Association. Although many people continue to spend holidays the traditional way, in recent years, Americans have established a new trend, traveling together during the holidays. David Kenny, director of Opryland International Travel in Nashville, Tennessee, says people travel during the holidays now more than ever.
The popularity is gaining because folks are changing from their traditional ways of staying at home. And now they're going to new destinations like Nashville.
Two of the first hotels to create Christmas extravaganzas are starting a trend nationwide. Representatives from cities and other resorts have visited Opryland Hotel in Nashville in preparation for their own packages. It celebrates a country Christmas, complete with old world tradition Yule log ceremonies, country celebrity storytelling, and breathtaking lights inside and out. The Broadmoor Colorado Springs 5-star resort hotel offers a European feeling with English carolers, tea at high noon, and ice skating. Or how about just watching the pros? George Fisher, manager for the Broadmoor, says the Christmas packages have become a great success.
So traditionally, the Broadmoor Hotel's occupancies have been down 20-25%. We thought this was a good time to try to build up our social market. So we put this package into place, and over the past 2 years, we've been very successful in bringing our occupancies up.
Actually, the occupancy rates were so low in the early 80s, Opryland Hotel was shut down, closed for 2 weeks in the middle of December. Currently, December is the biggest month of the year for leisure travel at both hotels. Over 45,000 Christmas packages were sold just last year, with occupancy rates up 53% at the Broadmoor and 89% at Opryland Hotel, while the national average occupancy is only 31%. Why do thousands of people travel during the Christmas holiday?
It has become almost a family tradition.
And it just seems to bring out Christmas.
Because the decorations and the tradition.
Feeding the duck here, and I like the decorations around here.
Well, I was just overwhelmed, absolutely.
Whether it's the Broadmoor nestled at the foothills of the Rocky Mountains or Opryland Hotel with all the scenery built inside, unique Christmas experiences like these draw millions of travelers out during the holidays, improve local tourist revenues, and prompt other hotels to follow suit, which means the trend of the early 90s might become the tradition of the years ahead. For Studio One, I'm Maria Volk.
Weather like this, it might be a nice change of plans. It's 25 minutes after the hour, and Tom and I will be back with UND women's basketball coach Jean Roebuck after this.
Is this thing working? At this sales presentation, I would like to show you our new facility. Can you see this up there? Take my word for it. It's really neat.
There is a
in Salisbury, Maryland, the hungry are being fed. In Wind Falls, Indiana, a man who learned to read at 47 is making sure others learn earlier. Every day, someone in America is doing something to light up another life. But there is so much more to do. The light to do it is within us all. We only need to share it. Call the Points of Light Foundation. Do something good. Feel something real.
I never saw anybody light up a bar like Jack.
You can say that again.
And a million jokes.
2 million.
Oh, what a riot.
Oh, yeah.
One of a kind.
No kidding.
I swear, if I thought he couldn't drive, I'd have said something, you know? I mean, how could you spoil his fun?
Right.
Take the keys, call a cab, take a stand. Friends don't let friends
what?
Drive drunk.
Wendy, do you play basketball?
No.
You don't? Have you ever?
No.
You know, it's fun to see during your high school years growing up, men's and women's programs work very, very close together.
Yeah.
And I think that's a bit of a case here at UND. A characteristic about both the UND women's and men's basketball team is they've produced strong contending teams together over the last few seasons. The women's program opens their season tomorrow night against Morehead State. Women's head basketball coach Jean Roebuck, who begins his fifth season with the program, joins us this morning. Gene, good to see you again.
Nice to be here.
You getting itchy to get out there and see what the team can do?
Well, we've been practicing now for about 5 weeks. I think as a coach, I could use a few more weeks, but I think our players could have probably played a game about 3 weeks ago, so we're ready.
Any truth to that, Gene? Between the two programs, both the men's and women's have been done exceptional over the last couple years. Does it rub off on one another?
Well, the last couple years, you know, we both won the conference, and we were both nationally ranked. In fact, I think we were ranked number one at time at some period of time last year together. And I think there's a certain amount of pride within our own program and within the men's program to do well for the total basketball program.
Mm-hmm. What advantages does a male bring coaching a women's basketball team?
I really, you know, as a coach, I really don't see any advantage or disadvantage of being a male coaching a women's basketball team. I just think there's very good women's basketball coaches and there's good male basketball coaches, and you just have to do your homework no matter what gender you are.
Mm-hmm. Well, aside from strategy, Gene, and maybe I'm assuming too much on strategy, could you and Rich, you know, being the men's programs coach, could you flip-flop? Could you take the men this weekend? Could Rich take the women? And what kind of adjustments would you have to make?
Well, I really don't know what kind of adjustments that Rich would have to make. He's a great coach, and I think he could take a fifth and sixth grade team and do a great job. The adjustment I might have would be the men play up around the rim a lot more, and there's a little more intensity level around that part of the basket, and that might be a little bit of the difference. And I think the men's game is a little bit quicker, and things happen a little bit faster. So I think there would be a little bit more adjustment on my part.
Mm-hmm. Wendy and I were chatting before the interview about the difference between the two, if we could in fact find any. Rich cited the point guard and the center positions, as in all basketball, are the key two positions. Is that the case for Gene Roebuck's program and women's basketball?
Well, at UND, I've been fortunate to have a great point guard each year and also very good post players. So I would say he's definitely right. You have to be good at the point, and you got to be good in the post. And then your other perimeter players have to be able to shoot the ball, and hopefully you get another post player to complement the good one.
Do you have a young team this year?
Yeah, we're real young, and we're real inexperienced. We lost Whitney Meyer, an All-American last year, Beth Irie, All-Conference, Nadine Vandy Kirkhove, post player, All-Conference. So we lost our point guard, and we lost our post player, plus we lost an All-American. So we've got seven newcomers, and it's kind of been taking a little bit of time for them to get into the system and everything. And that's why I think we need a game to really see where we're at right now.
And you're coming off a 28-2 year last year. And Gene, I know it's just the polls, but the preseason polls have you guys at 11th. How do you feel about that? Does that fit you right, or are they overestimating or underestimating?
Well, I'm kind of happy, you know, losing three quality players, that they feel that, you know, we have a quality program and they're ranking us that high. I don't know if I'd rank us that high at this time, because there's a lot of unanswered questions right now, but there again, that's the polls, and they can do what they need to do.
Yeah, Gene, real quick answer. University of Oregon is coming in. They're a Division I school. New ruling has no more Division I and Division II playing. How is that going to hurt the program or help the program?
Well, this season, I believe, the University of Oregon is returning a game that we played down there. I think it was 3 years ago. And it's kind of that, you know, they felt they should come down and return that. But I do believe, and I'm not, we don't, you know, play a lot of Division I schools, but I do believe in the future that we are not going to be able to play Division I schools. And I don't know if that hurts the program. Definitely we'd love to play Division I schools, but they've kind of shied away from us, you know, throughout my career here. So it's not really going to affect us.
Gene, a pleasure to chat with you. Good luck tomorrow night. I don't think you're going to need any. It's going to be a terrific year.
Thank you very much.
You betcha. Gene Roebuck, UND women's basketball coach. We're coming up on half past the hour.
And when we come back to our second half hour, some holiday cooking and decorative ideas, a film preview on the Addams Family,
and a feature on Denver Broncos quarterback John Elway. Plenty to do, so stay with us. We'll be right back after this.
They're still building walls. Around some kids like these, walls that can keep them in classrooms away from other children, walls that can exclude them from many school activities. These kids are just like other children, except for one thing. They have epilepsy. While some need special help, they don't need walls. Children with epilepsy or other disabilities, let's count them in. Get the facts. Contact your local affiliate of the Epilepsy Foundation of America.
Real fire may start like this. Roaring flames, light. But within seconds, it turns into this. Thick, choking smoke. It's pitch black. You hear noise. You feel heat. But you are blind. Black. You hear noise. Feel heat. Fire is not what you've been led to believe in the movies or on TV. Black. It's a darkness so black, you won't find a window or door in a room you've lived in all your life. Fire is black. This message has been brought to you by the U.S. Fire Administration and your local station.
You could learn a lot from a kid. Seatbelts save lives.
Because a car might run over you, and then you might get smashed like a pancake or a bug.
You could stop really fast, and you could go right through the window.
I don't know why they don't wear their seatbelts. They're so easy to put on.
I always don't forget. My dad doesn't have to tell me, because I always remember.
You have to buckle up in both seats, front and back.
You should wear seatbelts all the time.
The weather. Glad to have you with us for this side of the hour. I'm Tom Buring, Wendy DeMartini on my right, Rhonda Fetting on my left. Yeah, that's right. That's right. Good to see you too. Folks, good to have you along this morning. Bundle up. The flu season is out. I'm sure you've heard what's going on in the South. Schools are closing, and it is chilly out, so bundle up.
It is, and Katie tells us it might be 20 degrees, but no snow.
That's right. Good news. The Addams Family opens tonight in theaters across the country. We have a preview of that. They have hired award-winning filmmakers on every end of this flick. All the characters are back, so it should be kind of fun. We were in Denver earlier in the football season and visited with Bronco quarterback John Elway, who has his Broncos sitting at the top of their division. We'll take a look at that feature.
And come hungry, as Brent Knope, the executive chef at the Pear Tree, will whet the appetite for holiday ideas that look and taste better.
Yes, and as we said, bibs are required. That should be fun. First, we'll take team into Rhonda with some overnight headlines and other news. Rhonda.
Thanks, Tom. The stalled Middle East peace process may soon be up and running again. A second round of Arab-Israeli peace talks has been set for early next month in Washington, D.C. The U.S. issued that invitation because Arabs and Israelis couldn't agree on where to meet next. The time and place won't be official until all participants respond, possibly by a Monday deadline. The head of the Palestinian delegation is on his way to Moscow to discuss the peace process with Soviet leaders. Israeli Prime Minister Yitzhak Shamir will meet with President Bush today. Shamir says there is room for compromise in coming peace talks. A hotel next to the UND Center for Aerospace Sciences is planning to break ground in the spring. CAS Director of Communications Tim Bierke says the hotel will cost about $8.5 million and is owned by private investors. Bierke says part of the hotel will be used to accommodate foreign pilots. He says the idea has been under discussion for several years. Bierke says the hotel won't be owned by the university, but will be part of the Center for Aerospace complex. Adults over 30 looking for a change may consider going back to college thanks to a scholarship program created by the Orville Redenbacher Popcorn Company. The scholarship Second Start was developed for the 30-something crowd who have limited resources and family commitments. For the third year, Second Start is offering 20 scholarships of $1,000 each. To be eligible, applicants must complete an essay on why they want to return to school. 14,000 people applied for the scholarship last year. Gary Redenbacher, grandson of the Popcorn King, returned to college at the age of 33. He hopes private industry can lend a hand in financing education for adults. The United States has proclaimed 1991 Year of Tibet. Next week, the North Dakota Museum of Art is featuring Focus on Tibet. UND Department of Philosophy and Religion, the College of Fine Arts, and the Multicultural Awareness Committee are co-sponsoring the Long Week exhibit. Tibet, known as the Forbidden Land, has nurtured a special form of Buddhism for nearly 1,500 years. Art, music, and mystical dance are important spiritual features of the Tibetan culture. On Monday, November 25th at 7, a sacred music, sacred dance concert will be held. Tuesday through Friday, the monks will be building a sand mandala in the museum. The mandala is similar to the Navajo Indian sand paintings. The exhibit is open to the public all week. Tibetans aren't the only people who have been expressing themselves through artwork. Studio One photographer Greg Bernstein visited with three artists at the University of North Dakota Hughes Fine Arts Center and brought back some video samples of their work.
You know, everything goes fine from beginning to end. And then other times I get halfway through it and it's like the idea that I had previously isn't working. And so I have to, you know, go back to the drawing board.
I like clay, it's a real physical thing. You know, you're loading kilns and messing with clay and getting dirty and making things you can use. The actual throwing of a pot doesn't take very long, but all the finishing work takes a long time. I spend plenty of hours here. I pretty much live in this room.
And I became a printmaker more than 20 years ago, and it fits my personality. It's very indirect. As a painter, you paint directly on the surface of the canvas, where in printmaking, you work on a surface and then transfer it to the paper. I do prints in black and white and in color. The color is much more magical because you see it develop. You see the print grow and change with each plate.
But when you put the color on the canvas and you see how they interact with each other, very often it's the color that has to change a bit. And so what I always work toward is trying to get a lively, a dynamic color sense on the paintings.
The Hughes Fine Arts Center encourages the public to stop in and check out the exhibits and galleries throughout the building. They also offer a wide variety of classes. Anyone interested should contact the center. Orville Redenbacher. He's been around for quite some time, hasn't he?
Since you've said it, I've mathematically trying to figure out if his grandson is 35, what does that make Orville?
Older.
A lot older. Rhonda, thank you. Paramount Pictures brings us this morning's movie preview and some memories from an old TV comedy. The Addams Family is back and on the big screen with Morticia, Gomez, Lurch, Thing, Fester, and all your other favorites. The film is comprised of a number of award-winning screenwriters, photographers, editors, costume designers, and special effect coordinators. Look close. Behind the makeup, there are some you may recognize.
When we first met years ago, it was an evening much like this. Magic in the air. A boy.
A girl.
An open grave.
You were so beautiful, pale and mysterious. No one even looked at the corpse.
Ah, miss!
Wednesday, play with your food.
Is this made from real lemons?
Yes.
I'll buy a cup if you buy a box of my delicious Girl Scout cookies.
Are they made from real Girl Scouts?
Dang, you're a handful. I've done this before. Last night, you were like some desperate howling demon. You frightened me. Do it again. What do we say?
Now.
Children, put down that antenna.
I'm blinded by such beauty.
How can I compete? You're twice the woman I am.
Look, a new chapter.
Scabs.
Don't torture yourself, Gomez. That's my job.
Trick or...
Addams Family will open tonight locally and nationally.
Yeah, trick or treat. This came with a package we got. It's an Addams Family t-shirt.
Nice cobwebs.
spiderwebs or cobwebs under the armpits. I'd give that to you, but this belongs to Francis Gondry from this point on, so we're going to give it to him. He's in our audience this morning. We come back, our visit with the prototype NFL quarterback John Elway after this.
Building for the future doesn't just happen. It takes time, planning, and a lot of hard work. It also takes people like you who overlook the inconveniences construction creates and a staff that's committed to providing quality banking services. During these final months of construction at Community National Bank, we pledge our best to limit these inconveniences and to make it up to you in warm, friendly, professional service. Because at Community National Bank, we care about you.
XL93, the number one hit music station. I'm Callan Davis. Coming up this hour,
XL93 Office Check.
Hi, where are you calling from?
From an office downtown.
XL93, the top five at five. Freeway party with Joey Rhodes.
It's Ruck and Rick on XL93.
Yo, baby, yo, the 9-1-1. XL93, the number one hit music station. I'm Pat Mars.
Knocking down 12 in a row every hour.
At least 50 minutes of non-stop music.
Only on XL93.
If you're an employer, we know how tough it is when your National Guard and Reserve employees are gone. But it's even tougher for them. Be a hero. Give your employees the freedom to protect ours.
The NFL draft of 1983 produced a class quarterback class still contributing to the game. Jim Kelly, Dan Marino, Ken O'Brien, Boomer Esiason, and John Elway. Elway is regarded by many as their prototype NFL quarterback. Strong arm, precise touch, good mobility, and proven leadership. He's taken the Denver Broncos to three Super Bowls and has earned a number of NFL honors. We were in Denver earlier in the season and visited with John about leadership, his dad as a coach, Denver's love for the Broncos, and those three Super Bowl losses.
It's never been hard for me. I've always tried to just be friends with everybody and play the best. If they know that I'm giving them 100% and they're going to turn around and give it back to me. So, I mean, I think that it's something that's going to be, you know, fortunately become pretty natural to me. And plus being in the position that I've been in, it's always kind of thrust upon you, so you kind of just assume the role. They are crazy about the Broncos here, and they live and die with the Broncos. I mean, people have good or bad days on Monday, depending on what we do on Sunday. So I think that, once you get here, you get used to it, you kind of becomes a part of it. But as far as extra pressure, no, I don't think that all you can do is go out and play the best that you can and hope that things turn out your way and go from there. But I think that it's always nice to be able to win for fans like we've got. Comes in this league wants a chance to win a Super Bowl. We've had three chances since I've been here. I haven't been able to get the job done. And that's disappointing. He's kind of always been my personal coach. And even though I never played on a team that he was the coach of, he was always the guy that I confided in and got a lot of answers from and asked him a lot of questions. And so it was, I feel, a big advantage for me to have somebody with his background in this league, in football and as well as other sports that he coached. So I thought it was always a benefit, and I wouldn't have had any problem playing for him. I think that it was just right for me to go to Stanford and San Jose State where he was, but I'd have had no problem. And then playing for him in the Shrine Game was a great experience. It's something that I always wanted to do and figured really it was going to be maybe my last chance to get to ever play for him. So it was a great treat for me to play for him. I'm not exactly sure how much longer I'm going to play this game. I've got 3 years left on my contract, and then I'll look at it after that. So that'll take me through 11. I really haven't started thinking about what I want to do after that. I know for sure that I'll take a couple years off and kind of reflect it. At times, I have a tough time seeing myself getting too far away from football because I've always, since day one that I can remember, Saturdays was a football game, and the week revolved around that. But as far as being able to lead the game, yeah, I can lead the game. I went into every one of those games knowing, preparing myself the best I could. I did the best I could in every one of those games, and things didn't work out. So, I mean, it's easy to walk away knowing that you gave 100% and it didn't work out. If I was in the back of my mind, didn't feel like I did everything I could to win those football games, then maybe I'd have some reservations. But knowing going into what I did to prepare for those games and work as hard as I worked, that I've got no reservations at all.
Wendy, this year has a little bit more incentive for him. This year, Coach Reese has Elway calling his own plays, so he's got a little bit of that twinkle back in his eye. His love for the game has picked up incredibly. He is, without question, probably the most mature, professional, gracious athlete I have ever met. A terrific guy. I want them to get a Super Bowl just before he retires. He's earned it.
Definitely. Some ideas to make your holiday eating look better and taste better when we return. We're glad you're with us. We'll be right back.
Is this thing working? At this sales presentation, I would like to show you our new facility. Can you see this up there? Take my word for it. It's really neat.
Advertisers are looking for just one thing from their advertising dollars: results. And that's what local cable TV advertising delivers. Results for local area businesses like ID Motor Company and Scott's Piano and Sound. Cablecom delivers results for these area clients. Let us deliver results for your business. Contact Cablecom for more information on local cable TV advertising at rates similar to radio.
The tragedy of child abuse takes many forms, from verbal assaults to hurtful blows. But it is preventable, and we all have a role to play. If you know of a parent having difficulty, reach out, sit down and talk. And if you're having difficulty, get help for yourself. Talk to a friend. Sign up for a parenting class. Take time out. Don't take it out on your child.
Contact the National Committee for Prevention of Child Abuse.
Who's doing the Thanksgiving cooking at your place?
Is it you? My mother.
Or your mother?
Dear
old mom.
I just eat.
Oh, Wendy. Oh, for the most part, that's probably me too. We thought it'd be fun to look at some ways to spice up the holiday appetite and menu. Not that you need it, but it's so easy to do. Brent Canope is the Pear Tree's executive chef, who would tell us just how easy it is and how good it looks. And Brent, it's terrific to have you.
Nice to be here.
We're talking about spicing up the holidays a little bit. Does that come with the flavor or appearance? How much is important?
It comes with everything, because remember, you eat with your eyes before you eat with your mouth. So here we have a naked dead duck, all right? We'll dress it up a little bit. While we're doing that, we're gonna start a little strawberry sauce for it. Nice hot skillet.
Mm.
All right, let that cook down a little bit. And just keep going around the duck. Okay, again, use the whole stem. It's already looking better.
Yeah, it is. But you know what my concern would be is if you spend all your time on the duck, on the appearance and the flavor, but you slack off in the rest of the meal, it's downhill from there. You've got to make this thing consistent all the way through, correct?
But if it looks good, who's going to look at you and say, does it taste good? No, just kidding. No. No, it's true. It's got to taste as good as it looks.
Mm-hmm.
But if it looks good, that's half the battle right there.
Mm-hmm. How about flaming do's and don'ts?
Be careful. I've burned myself many a times with using
paper
and stuff.
Yeah, does that mean we need to back off into the next building?
In a minute here. Okay, basically, anytime you're going to flame, you want the ingredients that you're going to flame nice and hot, because the alcohol getting warm is what is going to produce the fire. You also want to choose a liqueur or a liquor that is going to be high in alcohol content, such as a cognac or a 151, and then choose one for flavor. So we've got some strawberry schnapps and we've got some 151. You always add the flavor ingredient first. No, you're not gonna get much flame out of this one.
What are some other options to traditional Thanksgiving and Christmas dinners?
You've got duck, you've got goose. A lot of people are going with rock Cornish hens these days. All right, a little flame there. And just kind of mix it up there a little bit.
Why are you pushing me into the...
Chili, one way to warm up in North Dakota.
That's okay. We're all right.
Okay, and basically, for a little table-side presentation while it's flaming, just put it right over the duck.
Looks terrific.
Yeah, it does.
Cornish hens, a lot of people are going with lamb these days.
Are they easier to cook than a turkey, or are they...
Everything's easy to cook.
How elaborate does the kitchen have to be, though, to pull something like this off?
I'm doing it here.
It's this simple.
It's this simple. Okay, since I've got a little strawberry sauce left, let's get rid of this one.
Folks, it smells terrific. I wish we could throw this into your house, but
we've got a little baked Alaska here, and it's kind of fallen on the way over, but we're going to flame again. And you've seen in the cruise ships and whatnot, these waiters going through with their little flaming things of baked Alaska. All right, basically what they do, they warm up the booze, they just pour it right over the top. And again, it's all show.
But wait, smells wonderful. Wait till the flame goes down. Don't dive into it until the flame.
That's right. Hurt yourself.
Not that the alcohol is prompting the question, but what about beverages with meals like this? What do's and don'ts there? Things to serve, things not to serve?
It's pretty much up to you these days. They used to have the yes wine, red wine, white wine, and whatnot, and it's not the case anymore. Basically, you drink what you want to drink when you want to drink it.
Mm-hmm. What are you doing there?
If we have time here, we're going to start on a little flaming coffee. And basically, what we're going to do is we're going to toss a little booze around in these glasses and end up with a little coffee and finish off dinner.
I'm going to assume, Brent, for you and for a lot of other people, though, half the fun is not just eating it, it's making it, true?
True. Usually by the time Christmas comes, you're just about partied out.
Yeah, exactly.
So as much as you can do to excite you and the people that you're eating, it's good for you.
Now, how about for smaller gatherings, for a couple? Or even for a single, for a single person?
I'll cook like this for myself.
Do you?
Yeah.
So you're the Thanksgiving cook at home?
If I were home, yes, it would be.
Does it ever get tiring for you? You excited to see the holidays go by? You get tired of it by then?
We do a lot of business. Usually by the time Christmas comes, your turkey didn't dressing out.
Yeah.
And in fact, Christmas party started yesterday for us. So,
Brent, we are drooling. It has been a pleasure having you. It's been fun. We're going
to
have you back.
Thank you very much.
Brent is the executive chef at the Pear Tree Restaurant at the Holiday Inn. Go for some good, good eating. We'll be right back for more after this. But it's...
From Iron Maiden, drive home safe. Remember to strap yourselves in with your safety belts. You don't want to end up like Eddie.
Belt up. Don't be a dummy.
Who ever thought this would happen? An English teacher from West Virginia teaching in Budapest. I'm part of the first Peace Corps team in Eastern Europe. It's an amazing time to be here. I'm learning Hungarians are a lot like we are. They love their freedom, and they're open to new ideas.
The government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth.
There's a lot of work ahead of us, but I can't think of any job I'd rather have.
Peace Corps, the toughest job you'll ever love. The animals in the forest. If they could talk, what would they say? Say, be careful with fire in the forest. Just like Smokey says, only you can prevent forest fires.
Just kind of wondering if any of us had a straw here or a fork. Folks, I tell you, I wish you could smell it. It smells incredibly good. We're not going to be here next week, so we want to wish you a very, very happy Thanksgiving next Thursday, folks. Kate, what about the weather for this weekend?
Well, kind of chilly, temperatures in the 20s, but no rain or snow. Maybe some flurries today.
Okay, good to keep in mind, folks, if you're driving away for the holidays. Have a great weekend, everyone. For Wendy, Rhonda, Katie, I'm Tom Buehring. And again, because of the holidays, we won't be here. We'll be back in 2 weeks. We leave you with some clips from the Addams Family. Bye-bye, everybody. Okay, who starts?
It was an evening much like this. Magic in the air. A boy.
A girl.
An open grave.
You were so beautiful, pale and mysterious. No one even looked at the corpse.
Ah! Miss!
Wednesday, play with your food.
Is this made from real lemons?
Yes.
I'll buy a cup if you buy a box of my delicious Girl Scout cookies.
Are they made from real Girl Scouts?
Dang, you're a handful. We've done this before. Last night,
you're like some desperate howling demon. You frightened me.
Do it again.